All right, we are live on Facebook and YouTube. Thank you, everybody, for joining us. If you're watching the replay, or if you are live here with us, we really appreciate all of your support on our ongoing live stream. It's been a while. It's been a while since we've been here with Jochen. He's been very busy, but we're really, really grateful to be back. And we have a lot of amazing questions today. That we're going to be tackling with you guys and with Jochen. So if you are tuning in, please feel free to drop a comment in the chat box of where you're from. And if you do have any questions, feel free to also leave them in the chat box. And I gather them all, and we typically answer at least four per session. Sometimes some of the questions tend to be longer, but if they do run over, we use as many or we get to as many questions as we possibly can. So we'll get to yours eventually, so please do leave them in the comment section. I'm just going to go ahead and make sure that we are in fact live on Facebook. Yes, I see that we are, and we are in fact live on YouTube as well. All right, so let's just move right on ahead and welcome Jochen into our live stream.
Hey, Mary Claire,
Welcome.
how are you?
I'm great. How are you? Welcome back.
Good. Yeah, I was thinking about when was the last time we talked? It was a while, wasn't it?
It was a while ago, yeah. I'd say at least a month and a half. So it was a long time ago. It's
Yeah,
great to be back though.
we have to get back in the swings now that I'm in quarantine again.
Yeah. We have a lot of questions to answer today, so really looking forward to this session.
Yeah, and it's so exciting because we launched the DIY saddle, and I understand we might change the name to a duo virtual fitting system. Have you heard about that?
Sorry, you cut up.
We're
You
changing
broke up.
the name DIY fitting system to a duo virtual fitting system.
Oh, amazing.
Have you heard about that?
No, I hadn't actually.
Yeah, so most feedback we heard was people say, "Oh my God, this is so exciting. There's so many adjustability on that saddle, but I could never do it myself." And unfortunately, it was never intended to do it totally by themselves. It's always with two. And in our saddle companies, we have several different models. One of them is the model Quartet, and the reason why we chose that name because it has four unique features of our top-selling saddles. And we're thinking of changing the DIY fitting system to a dual virtual fitting. You know why?
No, I don't know why actually.
Because it's with two people. We do it online with people. That's why it's called virtual saddle fitting.
Awesome.
And I think people will understand a little bit more. They're not left alone because there is so many things. This is why we do this online free Thursday evening seminar for everybody where they can ask questions. And once you have your horse in front of you and you want to know how adjust, it's, oh my God, there are so many adjustabilities. I don't want to do anything wrong. And how am I going to go about this? And that's why we want to strongly mention this is always meant with a support team and on the side. You know,
Exactly.
everybody has cell phones, and with FaceTime, it's so easy. But that said, doesn't mean that after you've done it a couple of times, you feel very comfortable doing it. After all, we're not shipping people to Mars here. It's not rocket science. It's pretty straightforward. But this is hopefully this hour and continue going on that we explain more and more to people while we're doing this here.
Right. Yeah, I posted actually some questions, or I posted some questions on our story on Instagram, and we got so many questions about the new system. So I've kindly directed everybody to join us tonight. So this is going to be an excellent session. Yeah,
Yeah.
all about the dual system. So we're really looking forward to that.
I think what people really don't grasp is this, how can you fit a saddle online? like a virtual saddle fitting, that's where people really say it's impossible. How can somebody in the computer or on my cell phone help me fitting my saddle in my barn? And I hopefully we can clear this up. But should I do a little intro first?
Sure.
As usual. Okay.
Yeah, so I love your intros.
We make it very fast, but just for everybody who's joining us again, thank you very much for coming back. But for everybody who is the first time there, welcome. And I would like to tell you quick about my favorite subject, me. Just kidding. But people always want to know, why does he say these things with so much confidence? Very easy, because I grew up in a household of teachers, and my dad always taught us the person who knows the why is the person you need to follow. It's an old saying, the person who knows the how will always follow the person who knows the why. And that's what I made myself as a from a childhood. I surrounded myself with people who are smarter than me, and I wanted to find, when it comes to horses, who are out there who really know all about horses. And veterinarians whose motto is do no harm to horses, professors who study ongoing the well-being of the horses, how can we help horses better, not only when they're injured, but before they get injured. You know, so in these three gentlemen here from Europe, one from Germany, one from Austria, and one from Switzerland, they have made this their lifetime goal, and they study the horse and have in their universities phenomenal results. And I learned tremendous stuff. But we also have veterinarians who are also riders. Dr. Gerd Horschmann points very often to say, you know, sometimes the sore back is not just the saddle, maybe the way the person sits on the saddle, or, which I find very interesting, in the saddle. And it is now the professionals who say, you know, maybe the horse is so sore in the back is how the horse is ridden, or how the saddle fits the rider, and that's why the rider doesn't swing soft with his back. Either or, the saddle is between two beings, and the saddle is just a piece of an equipment, a tool, an interface, what will take the shape from the horse and rider. Now, the saddle doesn't just sit on a horse and it's underneath the rider and nothing moves. The horse moves. And tools, here we have Saddle Fit for Life, that's the educational arm from Schlese, in Sao Paulo, where veterinarians use heavy-duty thermography. And after riding, we see a lot of areas here in the shoulder area of the horse where it's red. So it was fabulous what you can learn from all these different veterinarians. And when we come to sport, like jumping, show jumping, or racing, you know, for them, it's how can I make sure my horse gallops faster? How can I make sure my horse can last longer? And once I traveled the world and met all these wonderful people, such as Dr. Katarina Thiessen, who worked in the UK and worked in the USA and South Africa and dissected over 200 horses, what makes her so special is about the fact that she knew the horse either by video or personal, how the saddle or the equipment was fitting and how the horse was ridden. And fascinating how the bone and the bone deformity can tell a story. So from all over the world, and no introduction necessary for Dr. Sue Dyson, worldwide known, wonderful thesis she has written about the ethogram of the horse, how the horse shows pain. We have veterinarians who go a little bit deeper in the Meyer fascia of the horse. And we have, of course, veterinarian who says, you know, come on, have a little compassion for the horse. You know, the horse does speak. And we need to understand a lot of things has changed in the last 30, 40 years. And one of them is the breeding. You know, this expert, when it comes to breeding, is a published German author. And the book is unfortunately only in German, but it says from a flight animal to a designer horse. And with the breeding, we have horses now, what was mainly for use, plowing the field, getting the soldier from A to B, or riding from village to village, to more and more a sports horse. But something horrible happened. Horses now have super long legs. They barely can graze. They got to graze like a giraffe or bend with the knees. And when it comes to saddle fitting, the saddle support area is much, much shorter, and their breed is now super, super sensitive. They want horses more electric, they're hypermobile, and that, of course, changed a lot the saddle industry, because many, many trees and many, many saddleries and trades has passed on from their masters to the students to fit these type of horses. Now you can say, well, not everybody has those expensive super horses. They have every horse, absolutely. But what happened 50 or longer years ago, there was control when it came to breeding. Today, horses are shipped in boats and planes and all over the world, and they breed them with all kinds of different race. And what does that have to do with saddle fitting? Well, there are certain saddles, what are known as a thoroughbred tree, a quarter horse tree, when it comes to Western or English, the Arab tree. But now we have all these breeds mixed, so the standard tree doesn't fit anymore. So that was a huge challenge for the saddle manufacturer and the saddle fitters. But besides the breed, what else changed? The riders, the gender. So we have way more women now riding than male. Very simple, go in the tack shop. If you're a guy, good luck finding a lot of riding apparel. The entire equipment is geared to the majority of the riders, which are women now. Nothing wrong with this, except that many, many tack shops and many riders don't know or don't offer, if it comes to retailers or tack shop, saddle specific for women. Now you want to say to yourself, what is that? A saddle for women? I was in the same boat, because as a male, as a rider, as a trainer, as a coach, as a judge, I never thought about it. Because when I go to the store, I go automatic to the store and buy myself some breeches for males or jeans or whatever. I would never come to my mind to think, okay, let's shop in the women department. So what has that to do with the saddle? Your most important aid as a rider is your seat. Not your hands, not your heels, not your voice, is how you shift your weight in the saddle. And you're sitting on your structure, which is the pelvis. And the pelvis is the number one thing what's completely different from male to female. So while we're looking at bold pictures and fitting saddles for Western saddles, bareback riders, or dressage riders, let's don't forget that the majority of the riders, which we have now, are women. And when we want to think about, what has that to do? What do the experts say? Well, the experts say, if you're trying to ignore the fact, if you're trying to ignore that there's a big difference, the rider will have massive pain. Dr. James Worson wrote this book, The Rider's Pain-Free Back, right? And when I read about this, you know, I thought about, what about the quote in the Spanish riding school? This quote says, it is the utmost important not to cause the pupil any discomfort. With the cramped posture, it's impossible to achieve a pliable seat. So a pliable seat, if the horse moves, walk, trot, canter, the rider can absorb the shock, the swing, and can do sitting trot. First thing I learned as a saddle maker was in the seat form, make a nice, pointy ridge. And I asked the master, because that's how I was raised, I always ask why, understand why you form the seat form this way. And the master says, son, I thought you're a rider, you would understand. We form the ridge in the form, in the front, in the crotch, so the male parts go left or right. Now, as a rider, as a male rider, I completely understood. And I never want to ride on anything else, because it's very uncomfortable when we as a male fall on our male parts. So over years, over thousands of years, the master saddler, the male master saddler, taught the male student. But now we have the majority of women. No woman likes to ride on a rooftop. So what do you think when you as a woman sit on a saddle that has the front of the saddle where you sit in front of your crotch, a rooftop? Before you really, really get hurt, what you do? You lean back, you protect yourself from chafing, from rubbing, or like Dr. James Worson says, from chronic bladder or kidney infection, or lumbar, a severe lumbar issue, you lean back. And when you lean back, you cramp your seat. What does it say if the rider has not a pliable seat and has a cramped seat? The horse will suffer pain. So if you cannot swing your back, we as saddle fitters, you as a rider, we need to understand number one aid in riding is your seat, how you move your pelvis in the saddle. Number two, there are big differences between a male pair of breeches and a female pair of breeches. And the same thing goes to the saddle. There are 9 different features, how the seat is different from the male seat to the female seat. So if I would like to have 2 skeletons melt into one, the interface is the saddle. And the biggest difference here between male and female is the pelvis. Always start asking yourself the question. The saddle is an interface what helps you to protect your back and the horse's back from long-term damage. The saddle will never make you an Olympian rider and never takes away what you need to do. You need to learn to balance yourself and you need to learn to ride. The saddle is just simple, a tool. And if I compare the saddle as a tool, but let's say a hammer, for example, why would I take a sledgehammer to put a little nail into the wall to hang a picture? So you know yourself, there's many different hammers for different uses. Sure, I could use another example, but I would like you to all think the saddle is just a tool. The tool is to bring the horizontal spine and the vertical spine of the rider into one and to balance the rider so they sit aligned. This person is not aligned. This person sits in the male saddle. Subconsciously tilt her lower back and sits in the middle of the horse. Shoulder, hips, and heels is not possible. And without the perpendicular line, which means shoulder, hips, and heels, there is no way you get a pliable seat. And we just learned, and you just heard from the Spanish riding school, without a pliable seat, the horse will suffer pain. So if we all are really after that, we want to make our horses happy, we need to understand, and this is why I do what I do, when I would like to buy a saddle and I would like to fit it, start always with yourself first. Make a conscious decision. Do I want a tool what fits my anatomy, i.e. a male saddle, or if you're a girl, a female saddle? Don't even think fitting the horse if you don't even answer that first question. Once you have picked the right gender appropriate saddle, then you can start thinking about fitting the horse. Now, you need to understand that riding a horse is not meant by nature. And like Xenophon explained 2,500 years ago, he said, 2,400 years ago, Xenophon says, in order to have a horse lasting long, he demanded from his rider. Xenophon was the first Greek militarist who asked and wrote down, so he wrote down the instruction, he asked from his soldiers to ride the horse properly. What is properly? To engage the horse, what does that mean? To bring the horse's back up so the hind quarter came underneath, so the front legs, which are very, very sensitive, do not fall apart so fast. Okay, so we learned over our ancestors, horses only last 4 to 5, maybe 7 years in the wild. Now you think that's pretty harsh, but it is. You know, especially today, you know, wild horses are becoming more a nuisance to mankind. They get captured or shot from the helicopter. And if it's not man who kills the wild horses, it's other natures. It's their prey animals. They're not hunters. So when I have a horse what is in flight mode and runs away, sometimes they hurt themselves. Sometimes they don't get enough nutrition. Sometimes they fight for dominance. And guess what? The last horse gets eaten first. So what has that to do with saddle fitting, you ask yourself? Well, when humans took horses over, they capture the horse. And first, of course, we know from history, not only for meat and eating the horse, but they thought, wow, they can help me to plow the fields and pull my carts, and I can actually ride them. So while the horse got domesticated more and more and more, the one thing always stayed the same. The cannon bone, the ligaments, the tiny little bones in front are very, very fragile. And the horse won't last long, just like in the wild. One wrong step and the horse is done. So back to Xenophon. Xenophon taught his soldiers, if you change the horse's center of gravity, which is mainly on the forehead, mainly on the front legs, because a horse grazes 17 hours out of 24, and he walks in the wild 20 miles. So if a horse, what grazes on the forehead has to be ridden, then we need to build the horse up through training, bring the back up, get the hind quarters underneath, and then they become light and soft in the front, and they last longer than just 7 years. So then to mankind took horses on, bred them more, and we know it today as classical riding, or dressage is another word for training, and all the different sports. So what changes the horse's back? What influences the saddle? The way you train the horse, nutrition, veterinarian, you know, if you look after the horse, the tack, of course, your saddle, that's what we're talking about. Also how the chiropractor, veterinarian, which is shoeing, very important, age, condition, nutrition, and of course, how the rider rides the horse. So once you have find your gender appropriate saddle, this area is a constant change because we want to. We want to help these animals to last longer than just 5-7 years. We train the horse, they get more muscles. This area here behind the shoulder and off the lumbar, this actually gets shorter. Behind the shoulder and over the shoulder, that actually changes with age, nutrition, condition, with all of this above. You can even see a different shoulder angle before and after the farrier shot your horse. So there's various tools. This tool right here, this is over 116 years old. And by taking the circumference of the horse's body, you can instantly see the first changes. But the most important part, what I want to bring across, what has shown over hundreds and hundreds of years, but people always watched out for, is that little triangle. That's a very sensitive area. And of course, to stay off the spine. So from the bareback panels, or the bareback pillows, a tree got designed. And a saddle tree was designed to sit and bridge the spine and that nasty little triangle. So with all this said and done, with everything we hear, and we talk about fitting the male and the female, and now we have not just female riding English, of course we have male riding English, and we have female riding Western, but with the different curvature and the different pelvis in male and female, with the different size, sometimes you have very little people on very big horses or very tall people on smaller horses. We want to make sure the horse can perform protected from long-term damage. Doesn't matter if you're a short jumper, eventer, dressage, pleasure, etc. pp. Now, what I learned from all these veterinarians and what I wanted to share with you is that there is a very, very easy way of helping you and yourself in finding the right saddle. So long you understand, start with yourself first. I cannot stress that point more and more. The number one is you have to find your own comfort first. And next, I would ask yourself, do you want a disposable or non-disposable saddles? Saddle makers all over the world make two types of saddles. Saddles, what can be adjusted either by them or by yourself, and saddles what are not meant to adjust, which means every time the horse changes, you need to buy a new saddle or just ignore and keep beating your horse in case he stumbles, bucks, or bites. So if you don't want to beat your horse and you don't want to hurt your horse, I strongly recommend buy a saddle what can be adjusted either by your saddle fitter, saddle maker, saddle ergonomist, etc., or buy one of our new DIY saddles, also known as the dual virtual saddle fit system. How do you fit yourself? Very simple measurements. Either online or have somebody measure your hips, your upper leg, lower leg. Lower leg is very important. Many saddle fitters do not measure the lower leg because that gives you a very, very important ratio in terms of where your stirrup bar got to hang. And of course, circumference of your thigh, as well as the length from hip to heel. Once you have all these adjustments, you have a saddle what not just fits perfectly in the stirrup bar, also balance your saddle properly in the male or female saddle. If you don't, you will hear many, many clinicians say the same thing. And this is what is a common pattern, what I see all the time. The rider fight their equipment. Even talented riders, they deform their body to get it somehow done, but nobody can with their muscles or with their bone structures change steel reinforced wood trees or carbon fiber trees or plastic. There's no way you have that strength, even if you say Arnold Schwarzenegger can. Well, I doubted that he can squish his with his crotch steel reinforced wooden trees. So if we don't want to squish the horse or your saddle, listen to the experts. Who are the experts? Experts who have studied the biomechanics, the body of a human, which is doctors. And what I learned from them is the same what I learned from veterinarians. If you have saddle fitting, always keep in mind, what's the purpose? What you're trying to achieve? And what do we need to fit? So I think I'm spent too much time on this. I got a little hung up on that subject, Mary Claire, but I think it's very important for people to understand that it's so important to fit the rider first. And once you have that, you have the ever-changing horse where we need to fit.
Exactly. And Jochen, you know, even when you speak, anytime you speak, really, it's always massive value. And I think that's why people keep tuning in. So no worries about running long on that one. We do have quite a few questions today. And one thing that we've started doing as well is we're asking you guys to send in video questions. So if you have any questions for us and you'd like to be featured in our live stream, feel free to send us a question via a video and we will actually feature you in our live stream. So it just kind of makes that would be great. Awesome.
Hi, I'm Rachel from the UK. And my question is, why is it important to consider shoulder angle as well as wither angle?
Okay, I just played around
and
let's
hear
it again.
And my question is, why is it important to consider shoulder angle as well as wither angle?
Okay, so there is a big difference between shoulder angle and wither angle. So let's start with the shoulder angle. So this picture here is from a veterinarian's book by Dr. Joyce Harmon. She put a whip on the shoulder and a whip on the saddle. In front of the saddle, right here on the panel piping, is the tree point. So the tree point is right here. So I'll show you, you can see this is the front edge. So imagine this is where she lined up the whip. And then the horse shoulder blade, let me see if I have it behind me here somewhere. Yep, there it is. So the shoulder blade right here. So she aligned it from this, where my hand is. The horse has a 10 centimeter or 4 inch cartilage right here. Okay, so the whip was lined up right here. So why is that important that the angle has to match? Well, when the horse is grows, and keep in mind that the scapular, it's not attached like humans with via collarbone. They're big muscles where the ribcage hangs off, and through riding and training, that angle changes. Okay, that is what is very important to understand. So that angle, when the horse uses the upper arm, when the horse goes forward, that scapular goes back, upwards, backwards. So I'm going to go towards the camera this way. And what you want to do is you want to have that tree point or the tree angle parallel with the shoulder angle. Okay, so if I'm going to simulate this, the shoulder moves, I want that to go through here. I don't want the tree too tight, like you see this picture right here. However, that tree angle is too tight. Okay, so it's a very steep angle. So if the horse moves, it can clip right there. Or very often, the tree angle is too wide and there is no space where the D-ring is. Now, why is that so important? Well, when you sit in the saddle, gravity rules and it will come down because the angle of the ribs in the front and the high withers, there is what we call that serve the falling surface. In the back of the saddle, the back angles are much flatter. We call that the supporting surface. So the back, the saddle doesn't slide as much or doesn't want to slide down as the front due to the fact we have a steeper angle. So if we look at the texture of the horse's withers, I'm going to show you the spinal processes on the wither. You can see down here is the vertebrae. And I'm simulating with my arm, on my hand, the skin would run here. So here where my fingers are, there's a lot of different muscles. And these different muscles, they don't want to be squished. Now I showed that little picture earlier in my introduction, that red triangle, that's right there. I have another little sample, I can make it more visible to show. I have to get it out from here. Let me just take that camera off. Maybe it's easier to see. So you can see how deep and how many muscles there are. We don't want to pinch us. So the saddle needs to find the support on top of the ribs. So if the tree angle is too wide, it will, where my pen is, dig into these muscles. The tree angle needs to be the same angle like the shoulder is, so the shoulder can slide back and forth and find support on top of the ribs without squishing the wither muscle. So let me go back to the picture so you can see. So if you can't run a pencil between the D-ring and right there, that's most of the time 3 inches down from the withers, you know by the time you girth on, and you know by the time you sit down, it squishes the muscles I just explained. Here is perfect. You could run your pencil down 3 inches, no problem. There's this little gap, tiny little gap between the wither muscle and the D-ring. So when the girth is on and the rider sits down, remember what I said? Gravity rules, this will come down. It's still parallel with the scapula. When the horse moves, it will come back. So that's a tree angle. It cannot be too steep like this one on the left or too wide like this one. It needs to be the same angle like the shoulder so we don't clip the cartilage or hit the bone. And it also creates that freedom for that triangle in order to not squish the muscle. Now the tree width. The tree width is from D-ring to D-ring. So that is very important because you may have seen a young horse, 3 years old, 3.5 years old, you start riding him and you groom the horse before you ride. And you will see that your brush barely goes between the front two legs. He has no muscles yet. And after a year, you will see your brush goes easy between the front legs. So what happened? The chest opened. And let me find my shoulder blade again. Here we go. So we talked earlier about angle. Now we talk about width. So the whole horse became wider in the shoulder. So you say, well, I heard from other saddle makers and from my trainers and from Pony Club, the saddle should never sit on the shoulder. Absolutely correct. But guess what is moving upwards, backwards? And guess what you're trying to fit? You're trying to fit the shoulder because the shoulder moves 6 to 8 inches sometimes all the way back through the saddle. Now imagine you have a horse with a high withers, very narrow high withers, but a very broad shoulder. How are you going to fit that if the horse is a jumper and both shoulders come back? So it's really important to, what have you got here going on? Really important to understand the distance on the D-ring. You see the diagram on the left, okay? Comes narrow, medium, or wide. Of course, it comes in way many more adjustments, but just to keep it simple. That does not necessarily mean that the angle, see, this is all red. It's all at 45 degrees, okay? So that does not necessarily mean that the angle changes. That's just the width. Then you can have a saddle, what is the same width from D-ring to D-ring. But look at this, the blue is a steeper angle than the red or the green, okay? So to summarize the question, in order to have a nice movement in the shoulder, what I need to have the shoulder angle, and that's what the short tree angle does. And what I also need to have for my horse in order not to hurt the cartilage, here you see a tree on the horse, what is dissected. Here you see the shoulder blade. Imagine there's muscles on underneath and skin. And then of course the leather. What will happen if the rider sits down? All this comes down. Underneath the fascia here, you will see the bone and the cartilage right there. Many horses have damaged cartilage and damaged shoulders because two main features have not taken in consideration. Number one, the distance from D-ring to tree point, how the angle was. And number two, the distance from D-ring to D-ring was not wide enough to have the tree width properly taken in consideration. That's why it's so important to understand when you buy a saddle, always understand, is the tree wide enough for the scapula to slide underneath? Wide enough from D-ring to D-ring. Then is the angle properly? So when the horse moves, okay, pay attention to this cartilage here. It goes upwards, backwards, okay? So every time the horse strikes forward, boom, the leg goes, the scapula comes back. So you want to think in terms of this is the angle of the tree, this is the angle of the shoulder, they need to slide, okay? If the angle is wrong, they hit, they destroy each other. The tree doesn't get broken, your horse gets broken. So I hope it really brought this clear. Because if you ignore that, the horse has a way of compensating and most of the time by hollowing, and you see a typical ewe neck and they seize all up and the whole horse cannot move properly through the big joints and the little joints go. This is a very sad picture here. The video is a little slow, apologize. But you can see this is not a normal canter and a good sound looking horse. It's so sad that many, many, many saddle fitters do not pay attention to tree angle and tree width. Thank you.
That is such a difficult video to watch, Jochen. Every time you play it, my heart just drops. But thank you so much for that wonderful explanation, because it has covered that topic in various ways. So that's amazing. Thank you so much, Jochen. So let's move on quickly onwards to our topic of the day, which is the dual fit system, or the DIY system, as some of you might know it as. On our Instagram page today, we discussed some of these topics, but we're going to look at this in depth. So the first question is, how are the new DIY saddles more adjustable than our other saddles?
Okay, so let me find a slide first. So maybe I'm a big believer that pictures say more than 1,000 words.
Absolutely.
Yeah. So one of the things is that when people say, oh, I bought an adjustable saddle, what does that mean? Adjustable means it needs to be adjusted in the flocking. Some people can do it with stuffing. Some can do it with rasping the foam. But what we're trying to do with adjustable saddles, we're trying to have a solid contact in the center. So the DIY or the doer virtual saddle fitting system is where we will, together with you, can even make this difference. On an existing saddle, we can now make the channel spacing. And no other saddles on the market is where you can, over long distance, together with your saddle fitting expert, together adjust the saddle so the panels have the right space for the horse's spine. This is absolutely important. The other non-heard of is that we now have the ability to fit horses. We just talked about what if you have a horse with a super narrow withers, but a super wide shoulder. So we can now, no saddle on the market can adjust the gullet plate. There's many on the market, what you can with the screw bring a narrow and wide, but the angle is what changes. And where my pinky is where the D-ring is. That changes very little. And no saddle on the market is where you can do an orthopedic saddle fitting. 7 out of 10 horses are bigger on the left side. And if you have a gullet plate, what is symmetric, it will dig into the left side and it will shift. Now you could say, well, it's the job of the trainer and the farrier to make the horse straight. How long does that take? A day, an hour, or month, or years? And what if you can never, through corrective shoeing or corrective training, fit it or get the horse 100% symmetric like most saddles are? What if the horse, like this one here, you're looking at the front, rib cage, shoulder blade, upper arm, lower arm. What if the horse, like many do, compensated for the unevenness? Are all humans absolutely even? Are we really under the impression that our organs and our body are 100% symmetric stacked? Or do we have a little bit more weight on one side than the other? A horse, what grazes, put one leg forward. Pay attention how many horses graze with the left leg forward and how many horses have the mane to the right. Many, many horses look like this. Now, if you under the impression that you can, through proper training and shoeing, make your saddle, a horse, symmetric, what will happen the whole time you ride the horse with the tree, what is too narrow on the left side? It will dig violently, horrible into the left shoulder. Maybe there's a common pattern here where we see the first injection is the right hock, the front leg is the first splint, front left. And maybe we see a lot of problem on the left shoulder because we ignore that. So question, what makes that DIY system so special? That's the first gullet plate you can, together with an expert, change in the width, in the angle, but also do an orthopedic adjustment, left and right, to match this horse. The other cool part, what makes that doer system so desirable, you have now the ability to change the length of the panel. You, together with your expert, can figure out how long the panel, whatever in here, needs to be without putting pressure into the lumbar area or into the cartilage area of the horse. No saddle in the market has right now a saddle where the pressure is so easy relocated to make sure it does not is too long or too narrow on the spine. What else can you do? The usual, what most saddle companies can do, you can do the flocking, you can change the billets, you can have the billets on the left side, different than on the right side. Why would you do that? Well, we talked about asymmetric horses, typical horses with the bigger left shoulder, you're looking at those from the front, need the girth, a little bit further back, and on the side where the horse is less developed, you need to have the girth straps more forward. If you say, that's ludicrous, I make it 100% symmetric, what do you think your girth are gonna do? The girth follows gravity and it will go to the narrowest area. The horse with a less developed shoulder has the girth groove more full. There's nothing you can do, no matter if you're an Olympian rider or a double ink doctor and have the highest degree, you cannot fight gravity. The girth will go to the smaller pocket and will torque your saddle. So the DIY system has a unique billet system what can completely, completely de-stress the torquing from the billets. What else is so special? Well, we talked about the channel size, how narrow we can do it. We also talked about the panel length. But what I think is the heart of the system is that we have an ability to keep changing it when the horse gets bigger and bigger and bigger, because the serratus and the pectoralis, they get wider, the shoulder gets wider. You can constantly change the gullet plate. And how does it change? The easiest way to adjust, to explain it is think of a car. A car what has gears. Before you shift the gear, you need to hit a clutch. Once you hit the clutch, the gear can change. And this is how the system works. You open with a screw the clutch, you adjust it, and you close it again. It's not the screw what holds the system. It is the combination of the clutch and the gear, how this system works. So the question, how often can you do it? Forever. So long you make sure you open the clutch. Same with the car. How long will my gears last? You can jerk that gear in there without hitting the clutch, but maybe your transmission doesn't last so long, or your gear shift. So the other cool part is, because it also changes independent from the width and the angle, you can always make sure, like I just explained to Rachel, never to squish these muscles here, the trapezius, rhomboides, splenalis, multifidus, super, super sensitive muscle. Okay, you can always make sure you get the angle of the shoulder and free up that area right there. So that is what makes it so unique, no matter in what training the horse is. If the shoulders, sorry, the elbow, the sternum, the elbow is one line, look at the angle of the rib cage and the shoulders. What do you think happens if the horse is fit? He brings his rib cage up. Have you ever seen a person with a bad posture? I guarantee he's that tall. Soon as he's bodybuilding or he has a good posture, he works on his upper body's muscles, he all of a sudden grew. It has nothing to do with age. It has something to do with conditioning, proper training, and with the horse too. Horses can fall and rise in the rib cage. Sickness, season, type of training, and this constant change, well, your saddle has to be checked 3 to 4 times, as the latest experts say, bodybuilders, body workers, who say, hey, you know, you really need to make sure you follow the shape of the horse all the time. So you got to check your saddle 3-4 times. People say to me, oh my God, that new Duo virtual saddle fitting system, I can save $1,000 a year. That's unheard of. No other saddle gives you this ability. So how can we be so sure, and how can we make sure we can adjust the saddle so many times without hurting the tree or make the tree twisted? So let's look at this area again. This is the area where the gullet plate is and the stirrup bar is. So every saddle on the market has a tree, unless you go with the bareback pads or treeless. And every saddle, even a treeless saddle, which has a stirrup bar, is where you attach your stirrup leathers. And the stirrup bar is most of the time in the front. So in order to avoid the pressure on the spinalis from trapezius, from rhomboides, you want it on this big fat muscle here on top of the ribs. What do you think sits in that area? What do you think causes this severe dip? It is this stirrup bar, what is most on all saddles worldwide. So if I'm looking at a saddle, okay, here we have a typical old fashioned wood tree. Many companies still use that. Okay, so every time you put the weight on it, it's attached to the front of the saddle into the gullet plate of the cell. So the DIY system has completely re-engineered, because every time your saddle fitter adjusts the wood tree, they shouldn't, but many do, and they widen it, it puts force on this, because this is connected, and twists and forks your saddle tree. How is that possible with the DuoFit system and not with the other saddle? It's a stirrupper. The new stirrupper is completely new, because rather than attached in the front, it's attached where my fingers are. So every time you stand, you post, you jump, the pressure is in the front, the pressure is in the front. Now, while the stirrupper is still here, the redesigned stirrupper is attached here. Now the saddle is held down in the middle, and you jump, it doesn't flip up. This is how the stirrupper looks like. It has a hinge, it's all been tested. It has a safety loop, has no pressure, has no bearing unless something severe happens. It is attached where my hand is. I'm gonna stand up to make it a little bit more easier to show. There you go. I need 13 arms. Okay, I put it on top so you can see it better. So this is where it's attached. It's attached in the center. This is completely free in the front. So this here can be adjusted to any size you want, and it is not connected through here anymore, so it doesn't twist the saddle. But the unique part about the center balance stirrupper, you can have it very far forward or further back, depends on the rider's leg measurements. We talked about earlier how important it is to know the lower leg measurement, right? That determines where that stirrupper sits. So it doesn't push into the rider's leg, it doesn't push into the horse's body, it finds this happy medium spot. And when you stand in the stirrup, the saddle is held down in the center. This makes that saddle so adjustable, what is not even close on the market. So the DuoFit system, Duo again, because you do it together with your saddle fit expert, has now the ability to decrease the pressure, like you see here on this slide on the withers, decrease the pressure on the spine. You don't see this total atrophy on the spine because your channel is too small or the panel is too long and you see these horrible holding. We can now really, really look into it and says, we don't need to cripple these horses anymore and cause this massive kissing spine, because under guidance, we can help people to say, let's make the channel the right width. Let's make sure the horse doesn't get these huge, huge spots we see over and over here again, too tight stirrupper. Where do we always see pressure on white hair or dry spots? It's in the front or in the back. So horses will comply because I can force them either with whip or force. But what will happen if we do not follow the shape with the gullet plate, with the panels, with the spandrel width, most important with your billet system, your saddle will fall to one or the other side and the spine will deviate. You know, you will have problems. You see many horses, especially Western horses, they think, oh, look at how muscular they are. They have massive problems. Okay? Massive, it separates here, pinches there, or you see, stand behind the horse, you see uneven hips. You can sure have a good chiropractor. What good does that do? If you adjust your horse, but you ignore completely the channel width of the horse, or you ignore completely which side the horse's mane goes, the saddle will follow in the hollow side, the girth will pull it forward, the spine will deviate, and many horses run around with rib supplication or rotated vertebrae, vertebral rotation, and you wonder why they kick out to your leg. This is nature. This is very often man-made, I know. But if we don't look at this, we don't fit in it, we will have issues. If we want to stay away from BL13, that's from the respiratory health, that's the lung meridian point, you need to be able to to have the control, you as the rider or as the saddle fitter, to stop making the saddle slide forward. No other self-adjusting saddle on the market, there's approximately 9 on the market, can do this. We are able to do it. So there is a lot of talk about the saddle, because this DIY or dual fit system is the only saddle what comes under 4.66 kPa. All other saddle, they are way above 8 and cause more damage to the horse's spine. The first saddle we come under the 4.66 or by nade line or the PSI panel, but with the DIY saddle, you'll be sure you're standing around the 3 mark. So you are quick there, 24/7 availability for you to have help when you need your saddle fitted with an expert so the shoulders can move. And that's all your goal. Stay away from these nasty little reflex points. And that's why the saddle is unmatched on the market.
Awesome, Yachin. And I think one of the other great points as well is the more that you're involved with this, the more that you're learning, the more that you're grasping and absorbing all of this information. And that's why, you know, the dual aspect of it is so valuable, because not only are you actually getting all of this, getting your saddle fit to this degree, but you're learning what it takes to really, you know, to understand this interface and to kind of keep this fit going. So you'll understand more what's happening when you feel something's off, and you'll, you'll start to grasp saddle fitting more as a whole. So incredible value.
Sorry to interrupt. I know time is up, mm-hmm. but I thought it's very important. No other saddle can make the curve of the bars. You know, the horse have different backs. Is it because the rider believes in crank and pull and kick and push, you know, and rides them hollow? Look how the horse's back is curved. And then he goes to another trainer and he makes that horse bring the back up, haunches underneath, light off the forehand. Now the back is straight. So if the rider has one saddle but two different coaches, he or she can change the curvature on the bottom of the saddle. How cool is that? No self-adjusting saddle has that ability.
Right. Incredible. Yeah. Awesome. Thank you so much, Yachin, for that amazing question. And we have a bunch of other DIY questions, dual fit system questions. And I actually just posted the link in the chat box if you guys would like to check out the page on our website if you have additional questions. But again, we will be back next week, next Thursday, for another session with Yachin. So
What we should do, maybe I should have a DIY saddle and show it directly on the saddle. And show people how to do it, because I think people would be amazed to see how easy it is to change the bar, curvature, the length, the spade, the panel, the stirrup bar. So I think we should really make it short, make it maybe the dual system continue 2 or something like that.
Yes, a demo next week.
Yeah, wouldn't that be cool?
So yeah, sounds great.
Then we can do that.
Okay, everybody, thank you for all your questions, and look forward to next week. Join us next week for a DIY duel, a demo. Okay, here's our outro sequence.